अस्सलाम वालेकुम स्टूडेंट्स, होप यू ऑल आर फाइन। इन द प्रीवियस टू क्लासेस यू हैड कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ पेरिटोनियम, देन द डिफरेंस बिटवीन पेराइटल एंड विसरल पेरिटोनियम एंड हाउ द पेरिटोनियम इज थ्रोन इनटू फोल्ड्स एंड लिगामेंट्स। पेरिटोनियम हैज कॉम्प्लेक्स अरेंजमेंट एंड इन ऑर्डर टू अंडरस्टैंड और टू मेक इट ईजी we will trace the peritoneum both in vertical as well as in horizontal sections. So in this diagram we can see the sagittal section of abdominal cavity and in which we can see the organs, like this one is liver, this is stomach, transverse colon, small intestine, some organs which are present retroperitoneally like pancreas, second part of duodenum, and then some subperitoneal viscera like urinary bladder, and this one is uterus. Now as this peritoneum, when it covers the wall of abdominal cavity from inner side, it is called parietal peritoneum, and when it reflects onto some organ, the same peritoneum, this is called visceral peritoneum. And in between, when this reflects, like it reflects from liver towards stomach, then it is called fold, which is called lesser omentum. Now I will trace this peritoneum in the sagittal section to make you understand how the peritoneum reflects. When it covers the under surface of the diaphragm, it is parietal peritoneum. When it reflects onto liver, it forms a ligament. When it surrounds any of the organ, it is called visceral peritoneum. Here it surrounds the liver completely. Then for the fissure for ligamentum venosum, it reflects as double fold of peritoneum, which is called lesser omentum. Right, from here the anterior wall covers the anterior surface of the stomach, while posterior layer covers the posterior wall of the stomach. From here the two layers reflect as greater omentum. The anterior layer form first layer, and then it reflects back as fourth layer, partially adherent to transverse colon and move towards posterior layer. While peritoneum on the posterior wall reflects as second layer of greater omentum, reflects back on itself, continues on to posterior wall, and from here it reflects on as parietal peritoneum and will reflect again on the liver. Like this, it encloses completely closed sac, that is called lesser sac. Then the fourth layer reflects, surrounds the transverse colon, and then reflects back. This layer is fold of peritoneum is called transverse mesocolon. Remember, are these fold are double layer of peritoneum. Then again onto posterior wall, reflects, surrounds the small intestine and form fold of peritoneum, that is called mesentery. Again continued onto posterior wall, reflects and surrounds the sigmoid colon, form sigmoid mesocolon, then continue onto posterior wall as parietal peritoneum, then covers anterior surface of the rectum and posterior surface of the uterus. Here it encloses a fossa that is called rectouterine pouch, then reflects onto superior surface of the urinary bladder, and right from here it covers anterior abdominal wall, inner surface of the anterior abdominal wall, and becomes cat. Now you can see how the parietal peritoneum is in continuity and how it thrown into folds and ligaments. Now I will trace the peritoneum on this horizontal section, which has been taken at the level of epiploic. foramen, and we can see how the parietal peritoneum covers the inner aspect of the anterior abdominal wall, reflects onto liver as double layer of peritoneum called falciform ligament. From here it completely surrounds the liver as visceral peritoneum like this and reflects back onto anterior abdominal wall. In this way it covers the inner aspect of the anterior abdominal wall, reaches the posterior abdominal wall where it covers the anterior surface of left kidney. When it reaches here, it reflects from the posterior abdominal wall towards spleen, and this ligament is called splenorenal or linorenal ligament. Then it covers the spleen, and from here it reflects towards stomach as gastrosplenic ligament, and you can see the vessels which are present in these ligaments. Then it covers anterior surface of the stomach, and this is right free margin of the lesser omentum. Here it forms anterior boundary of the lesser sac and completes this ligament which is called gastrosplenic ligament. From it reflects onto posterior wall of the lesser sac in front of abdominal aorta, inferior vena cava, forms posterior boundary of the epiploic foramen, then onto anterior surface of the kidney which is retroperitoneal, and become continuous on the anterior abdominal wall. Then this peritoneum, which is parietal peritoneum, becomes continuous with this peritoneum on the posterior wall. In this way, this whole of the peritoneum with its reflection is in continuity. Now, what is peritoneal cavity? Peritoneal cavity is a potential space of capillary thinness between the parietal and visceral layers of peritoneum. This peritoneal cavity lies within abdominal cavity and it continues inferiorly into pelvic cavity. The peritoneal cavity is the largest cavity in the body. But please remember, it contains no organs. Right, it contains no organs. When we say some organ is intraperitoneal, it doesn't mean that the organ is present in the peritoneal cavity. Actually, the organ is said to be intraperitoneal when it is completely surrounded by peritoneum. So, peritoneal cavity is a potential space between the parietal and visceral peritoneums. This is parietal peritoneum and this is visceral peritoneum. So it contains only a thin film of peritoneal fluid. The peritoneal fluid lubricates the peritoneal surfaces so the viscera move over each other without friction. It allows the movement for digestion that are required for digestion. Plus peritoneal fluid contains leukocytes, antibodies that resist infection. The lymphatic vessels which are present particularly on the inferior surface of diaphragm, they absorb the peritoneal cavity. Now please notice that peritoneal cavity is completely closed in males. But in females, there is communication to exterior as uterine tubes have opening, and through this opening, this communication constitutes a potential pathway of infection from the exterior. Now, a few important clinical points related to peritoneal fluid. Normally, less than 50 ml of fluid is present in the peritoneal cavity, but if it is in excess, if there is an excessive accumulation of peritoneal fluid in the peritoneal cavity, the condition is called ascites. Now, ascites can occur secondary to hepatic cirrhosis, when there is portal venous congestion, in malignant diseases. It also occurs in congestive heart failure, when there is systemic venous congestion, as well as in tubercular peritonitis. These are few of the causes. In a thin patient, as much as 1500 ml to accumulate before ascites can be recognized clinically, but much less amount can be traced on ultrasound. Then there is another condition that is called hemoperitoneum, that is collection of blood, while pneumoperitoneum is collection of air in the peritoneal cavity. Now this diagram is showing you the presence of ascites in the peritoneal cavity, fluid in the peritoneal cavity which causes distension of the abdominal cavity. Drainage of peritoneal fluid is called paracentesis. The sites for paracentesis, the one site is through median plane in the linea alba, midway between umbilicus above and pubic symphysis below, and the other point is supromedial to anterior superior iliac spine. The needle is inserted superior to empty urinary bladder in order to avoid injury to urinary bladder and in location that avoids the inferior epigastric artery. Now in this diagram we can see the sites for paracentesis. This is one of the site midway between umbilicus and pubic symphysis, and this is the other site supromedial to anterior superior iliac spine. And we must protect the inferior epigastric artery as well as a urinary bladder. Now, peritoneum is a semi-permeable membrane with an extensive surface area, and it overlies the blood and lymphatic capillary beds. Therefore, if fluid is injected into peritoneal cavity, it is absorbed rapidly. In case of renal failure, when there are waste products such as urea accumulate in the blood and tissues and reach the fatal levels, the peritoneal dialysis may be performed. This is one of the method for dialysis. The other one is hemodialysis. So in peritoneal dialysis, the soluble substances and excess water are removed from the system by transfer across the peritoneum. Peritoneal cavity is divided into greater sac and lesser sac. The greater sac is the main and larger part of the peritoneal cavity. This whole part in pink color, this whole part is called greater sac, and it extends even into pelvic cavity. While the lesser sac is a small area or cavity which is present behind this lesser omentum and posterior layer of peritoneum on the stomach. And lesser sac is produced due to gut rotation during development, and you will better understand it when you study the development of body cavities. The lesser sac is smaller and lies behind the stomach. The greater and lesser sacs communicate with each other through an oval opening or window. This opening is called opening of lesser sac or epiploic foramen. Now we will discuss the anatomy of lesser sac in detail. The lesser sac is also called omental bursa. It is a large recess of peritoneal cavity, and it is present behind the stomach and lesser omentum. And obviously it is lined with peritoneum. Now it is closed all around. You can see it is closed all around except where the greater and lesser sac communicate through epiploic foramen or foramen of Winslow. It extends upward as far as the diaphragm and downward between the layers of greater omentum. Boundaries of lesser sac. We can understand the boundaries of lesser sac with the help of this vertical tracing again. So this is lesser sac. The interior wall of the lesser sac is formed by peritoneum covering the caudate lobe and caudate process of liver when it reflects from fissure for ligamentum venosum. Then it is formed by posterior peritoneal layer of lesser omentum. Peritoneum covering the posterior wall of the stomach, and then the posterior upper part of anterior sheet of greater omentum, that is a layer 2 of greater omentum form anterior wall. The posterior wall is formed in the lower part by the anterior peritoneal layer of posterior sheath of greater omentum. This layer, that is layer 3, it forms the posterior wall of greater omentum of lesser sac in the lower part. Then peritoneum covering anterosuperior surface of transverse colon, then transverse mesocolon. More superiorly, the peritoneum of the posterior wall covers from below upward small part of the head, part of neck and body of the pancreas. In addition to this, it also lies in front of upper pole of the left kidney, left suprarenal gland, the commencement of abdominal aorta, celiac trunk and part of the diaphragm, and then it reflects onto posterior wall of the abdominal cavity. This diagram is showing the posterior wall of the lesser sac lined with peritoneum and the structures present behind this posterior wall, like commencement of abdominal aorta, celiac trunk and its branches, the left suprarenal gland, the upper pole of left kidney. These are the structures which form posterior wall in upper part of the lesser sac. Superior border forms where the peritoneum reflects from diaphragm towards liver, while inferior boundary runs along the line of fusion of anterior and posterior layers of greater omentum. Left border of the lesser sac is formed by these two peritoneal ligaments, the splenorenal, which is also called rhinorenal, and gastrosplenic ligaments. And inferior part, it is formed by the fused layers of greater omentum, while the right border is mainly formed by the epiploic foramen where it communicates with greater sac. And please remember that omental bursa permits a free movements of the stomach on the structures posterior and inferior to it. Now, the posterior wall of lesser sac is indented by crescentic peritoneal fold that runs from upper border of the neck of pancreas to upper part of the lesser curvature of stomach. This fold is called gastropancreatic fold. This fold is actually raised due to structures present behind the posterior wall of the lesser sac. In this diagram, the stomach has been removed and we can see the celiac trunk and origin of few vessels. So this is left gastric artery and this is hepatic artery. They raise folds in the posterior wall of lesser sac, which are called left and right gastropancreatic folds. Due to these folds, we can divide the lesser sac into various recesses. Above this fold, this is superior recess of the lesser sac. This one is inferior recess of the lesser sac, and this one is splenic recess. The superior, which is also called hepatic recess, it lies posterior to lesser omentum and encloses the caudate lobe of liver. This is superior or hepatic recess of the lesser sac. Then inferior or omental recess of the lesser sac lies behind the stomach and within layers of greater omentum. So this is inferior or omental recess. And the splenic recess is a part of lesser sac lying between the splenorenal and gastrosplenic ligaments. In this diagram, again, we can see the recesses in simple form. Above the fold, this is hepatic or upper recess. This is lower inferior or omental recess. And this is splenic recess. When we raise the stomach above and see the posterior wall of the lesser sac, and this is actually splenic recess between these two ligaments. Few important clinical correlates of lesser sac. The one is fluid in the omental bursa or fluid in the lesser sac. The common causes are perforation of the posterior wall of the stomach, then an inflamed or injured pancreas, which is present behind the posterior wall of the lesser sac, also result in the passage of pancreatic fluid in the bursa. Then splenic artery, which is present posterior to it, may result in bleeding from trauma or ruptured splenic artery, result in collection of fluid in the omental bursa. The next is epiploic foramen, which is also called foramen of Winslow or auditus to lesser sac. This is very important. It is a short vertical slit about 3 cm in height in adults, and it lies behind the free right border of the lesser omentum, which is also called hepatoduodenal ligament. It is the entrance to the lesser sac from the greater sac. This is the only communication between the greater and lesser sac. Now we'll see the boundaries of this epiploic foramen. In this diagram, we can see the anterior and posterior boundaries of the epiploic foramen. So this boundary, which is called hepatoduodenal ligament, which contains portal triad, that is hepatic artery, bile duct and portal vein. It forms anterior border of the anterior boundary of the epiploic foramen. The posteriorly, it is formed by inferior vena cava, right suprarenal gland, and behind that body of 12th thoracic vertebra. So these are the anterior and posterior boundaries of epiploic foramen. In this diagram, we can see the epiploic foramen in the right free margin of lesser omentum and how we can access from greater sac into lesser sac. Superiorly, its boundary is formed by caudate process and caudate lobe of liver, and inferiorly it is formed by first part of the duodenum. So this is epiploic foramen. Above, it is formed by caudate lobe and caudate process of the liver, and inferiorly by the first part of the duodenum. Please remember that anterior and posterior walls of the foramen are normally opposed, which partly explain that why patients can develop large fluid collections isolated to greater or lesser sac. So in this cross section, we can see the location of lesser sac. This is a lesser sac, and this is epiploic foramen through which it communicates with the greater sac. Now you can see the inferior vena cava in the posterior boundary. We can see the portal triad, the portal vein, bile duct, hepatic artery in its interior boundary. These are very important structures. In case of surgery, in reduction of internal hernia in the lesser sac, one should avoid the injury to inferior vena cava in the posterior boundary or portal vein, hepatic artery or bile duct in its interior boundary. This is another simple diagram, the inferior vena cava in the posterior wall, the portal triad in the anterior wall, caudate lobe and process superiorly and first part of duodenum, inferiorly the epiploic foramen. Peritoneal recesses. Recesses are small pockets of peritoneal cavity which are enclosed by folds of peritoneum. We have just seen the lesser sac, which is peritoneal recess. Other than lesser sac, there are some other recesses which are produced due to folds of peritoneum, like duodenal recesses, which are also called duodenal fossae. Several folds of peritoneum may exist around fourth part of the duodenum. So duodenal recesses are present around fourth part of duodenum, near the junction of duodenum with jejunum. And some of these are potential sites of internal herniation. One is superior duodenal recess. Superior duodenal recess is occasionally present, and when it is present, it is directed to left of the fourth part of duodenum, adjacent to second lumbar vertebra, and it is produced due to crescentic superior duodenal fold. We can see this one is recess and this is superior duodenal fold, peritoneal fold. And the important structure, the inferior mesenteric artery, lies under the parietal peritoneum. The next is inferior duodenal recess. Inferior duodenal recess is present in about 75% of individuals, and it lies to left of fourth part of the duodenum, adjacent to third lumbar vertebra, behind triangular inferior duodenal fold. So this is inferior duodenal recess and this is inferior duodenal fold. Paraduodenal recess lies a little to left and slightly behind the fourth part of the duodenum, behind a falciform fold of peritoneum. The free right edge of this fold contains very important structure, the inferior mesenteric vein. In this diagram, we can see the paraduodenal fossa, this one, and we can see the inferior mesenteric vein and ascending branch of left colic artery. This recess is the site of left paraduodenal hernia. Then retroduodenal recess, when present, it is largest of the duodenal recesses, but it is rarely present. It lies behind the third and fourth parts of the duodenum and in front of the abdominal aorta, and it is about 10 cm deep and it has a wide orifice. Beside duodenal recesses, we have cecal recesses. Again, the cecal recesses are produced due to peritoneal folds around the cecum. Some of the important are superior ileocecal recess, the superior ileocecal recess, this one, the inferior ileocecal recess, this part, and the retrocecal recess, which is present behind the cecum. These recesses, including the lesser sac, these recesses have the potential to become sites of internal herniation. Then remember that vermiform appendix frequently occupies retrocecal recess. It is present where? It is present in the retrocecal recess frequently. Then paracecal recesses are common sites for abscess formation after acute appendicitis. You have studied the types of hernias, the external and internal hernias, and you have studied the external hernias. Now, internal abdominal hernia. An internal hernia is a protrusion of a viscous, usually loop of intestine, through a normal or abnormal aperture within confines of the peritoneal cavity. Among the many potential sites for an internal hernia, the most common are paraduodenal hernias, followed by pericecal, and then hernias through epiploic foramen. So these hernia, these sites are those sites we have just discussed, the recesses which are produced around duodenum and cecum. And in this diagram, we can see how the loop of intestine enters through this epiploic foramen into lesser sac. This is type of internal hernia. Then this is another diagram showing you the paraduodenal hernias. Sometimes loop of intestine which enters the peritoneal pouch or recess and forms internal hernia, it becomes strangulated at the edges of the recess. Now remember that important structures form the boundaries of entrance into lesser sac, and traumatic injury to inferior vena cava in the posterior boundary or hepatic artery or bile duct in the anterior boundary can occur during reduction of hernia. Similarly, the inferior mesenteric vein, which lies in the anterior wall of paraduodenal recess, and one should avoid to injure the inferior mesenteric vein during reduction of paraduodenal hernia. So that's all for today. Thank you so much.